How is everyone? Really? Are you really? I mean, I don't understand. With everything that's been going on in this world, I mean, earthquakes in Mexico, I mean, it's disasters. Every time you turn on the news, it's just a mess. I mean, my heart, I mean, the floods, these hurricanes. I mean, my family, I've had one family member that's lost her home 3 times. I mean, it's just horrific. Here in our own state, these fires, the grass fires, hundreds of homes, people dying. And you're good? Really? Really? Shootings in Vegas? That made us happy, didn't it? That just thrilled us, didn't it? The politics that we have in this country? I mean, every time we turn the TV on, we're so blessed. We get to hear about President Trump and all the wonderful things. Everybody hates him. Everybody loves him. Our world's going just to hell in a handbasket. And that's just things that's not even attached to us.
Yeah.
How about your personal life, your relationships, your finances, your health? Aren't you just excited about it? Just getting bills that you didn't expect? I just got one for $900.
Oh,
okay. Oh, I'm so excited. I was just thrilled. Yeah, you're excited? Yeah, no, all of a sudden got quiet in here. What happened? But you know what? That's how we are. That's how we are. And someone says, oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. But really, deep down inside of us, we are not, oh, yeah. We're going to talk about 2 words today. Girls on my front row, your first word is hope, H-O-P-E, hope. To me, of everything I just mentioned, seems pretty hopeless to me. I mean, all these homes that just burned down, they've got now to figure out what to do, and the world we live in, all the process they have to do, they have to scrape the ground, and then they have to check and see if it's toxic, and then they have to clear out the property, and they have to let the ground sit for X amount of days. And my brother is a ground compactor inspector. Say that 3 times. And he says, you know, it's going to be months before some of these people are able to rebuild, even if they have insurance. We look around, and what we see is that life gets tough. Life gets really tough sometimes. And us as people, I'm being honest. Carrie said it a few minutes ago, you know, we all go through things, and we have things we have to deal with. But many times, we feel like there's no hope. Whether it's a relationship, or finances, or health, or children, spouses, employers. I think my biggest thing right now with me is my employer. And we almost get to the point we feel hopeless. And girls, you're going to write that word a second time underneath, and this time you're going to add the back of it, H-O-P-E. How do we spell hopeless? Can anybody raise your hand and tell me on the front row? Okay. That's all right. Okay. Then you write that underneath. Very good. You put a star by your hopeless too. Not that she's hopeless. But, you know, sometimes we feel hopeless. Do you feel hopeless? Have you ever felt hopeless? Have you ever felt hopeless? Why? Rogers. We all know who Mr. Rogers is. He's in the neighborhood. Once upon a time he shared, when I was a boy and I would see or hear scary things in the news, my mother would say to me, look for the helpers. You will always find people who are helping. To this day, especially in times of disaster, I remember my mother's words, and I'm always comforted by realizing that there are still so many helpers, so many caring people in this world. His mother was giving him hope as a young boy when he would fear and get scared. And I know our children, we've had many discussions downstairs, the kids and I, of things that go on in the world and things go on in their lives, and it gets scary. And it's okay to be scared, it really is. That's a natural attribute as a human. But we have to understand one thing, and that's that there is hope, that there is more good than there is bad, even though we don't see it, we don't think about it, because the world we live in focuses on bad, focuses on hopelessness, focuses on fear, scary. I mean, even Halloween, I'm not really that big of a fan, but you know, more people focus on scary than funny. Why? We live in a world that is fun to startle people. Why? I don't know. I do not like to get startled. You want to make me mad, startle me. And I guess that's just my defense of like, that's not funny. But there are more good than bad. The news does not put all the good on, does it? I mean, there's probably been a lot of good taking place over these hurricanes and these fires and these earthquakes. We had some men right here from the churches that went back and worked and helped some families from the hurricanes and the floods back there, and they were so blessed. Right here at home, there's things going on in these fires. My son-in-law is a deputy sheriff up in Yuba County, and things he's been telling us is just like, oh my goodness, how sad. But then again, he tells us something, I'm like, oh wow, how wonderful. You know, the things that we don't hear, but it's there. Because Satan wants to keep us in the dark. He wants to keep us in hopelessness. He wants to keep us in fear. And the problem is that we fall into it. How many times have you guys fallen into it? You know, even in your own life, when things are going rough, we just, and trust me, I'm a great crier. I can cry with the best of you. I can cry over a commercial. I can cry over a puppy dog. I can cry over a baby. I can cry over something truly sad. My tear ducts work really well. Really well. And we find that Satan is getting what he ordered. Do you ever think about that? He's getting what he ordered. He wants us to be hopeless. Now let's all face it, he's a loser. I mean, come on, loser. Satan, loser. And he wants us to be in his team. The happier he is the sadder we are. There's over 100 verses in the scripture that we find the Bible sharing with us hope. I read and read and read and read scriptures about hope. I thought, why are we so sad all the time? Why? Why when life pulls us down are we sad? We talk about that downstairs sometimes too, huh? We are to give him glory and praise, and we are to honor him through happy, sad, good, and bad. That's right. All things. But we get ourselves pulled down. Teenagers, he hasn't called me in 3 days. You know, elementary kids, it's not fair. I meant to spell the word. But you didn't spell the word. You know, I can't believe they're not going to pay me overtime. But you weren't asked to work overtime. We get ourselves so worked up over things. And we wonder why we are in this predicament. Maybe we need to check the scriptures. Maybe we're not going about things correctly. Maybe we're not looking at things correctly. Hope is a noun. Confidence, courage, desire, faith, possibilities. Light at the end of the tunnel. One little candle can put out so much light in the darkness. We came in this morning to turn on the lights, and this building is really dark. Just telling you. You ever walk in here, you're like, whoa. It kind of reminds me of the old warehouse. But we always came in through the sideway, and all that was left on last night was the little tiny light on the sound booth. And I told Craig, oh, they left the night light on. How precious. Because they knew I was coming in. They knew I was going to hurt my toes. And so, you know, that one little light put out a lot of light in this room when this whole room is so dark. One flicker of hope will spread like grass fire.
Come on.
And we are to be that hope. If you claim to be a child of God, you're that flicker. You're that hope. As long as there's breath within us, there is hope. There is hope. Hope is a verb. Believing. Do you believe there is hope? To be counted on, longed for, trust. How many times do you hear people go, I don't trust them? You probably heard me say, I don't trust nobody. I'm honest.
How
my husband knows it. Do I trust him? No. There's certain areas I don't trust him. I know it. Jim, babe, can you go make sure the gate's shut? Okay. 3 hours goes by. I go to get the trash. Gate's open. I come back in. Jim, were you going to shut the gate? Did you ask me? Do I trust he is hearing me? No. And you can tell him this? He knows it's true. Do I trust everything my boss says? Or my coworkers with their gossipy mouths? No. And I really try really hard not to talk at work. Because I don't want to fall into their pool. But can we trust God? Always. Always. Can we believe what he says is true? Always. There is hope when we search the scriptures. There's not always hope when we search the world, but there's hope when we search the scriptures. And when we put hope as a noun and as a verb, it has a very extremely large, large definition. And I don't care if you're as young as these young people on the front row or as old as the oldest adult in this room, we all have hope. And he hears each and every one of our cries. And he knows each and every one of our hurts. And he knows each and every one of our concerns. And he says, there is hope. There is hope. Psalm 71:5. For you, O Lord, are my hope, my trust, O Lord, from my youth. Someone just asked me this week, why don't you teach other places besides the kids? I do teach the kids a lot. You know why? Number one is because I really communicate well with them. I connect with them. I mean, they understand Disney. They understand, you know, fashion. We talk about shoes, right, Tina? We talk about shoes and hair and gel and fingernails and, you know, special kinds of candy. You know, we talk about important things. But I think what I like most about being around the kids is innocence. Kids under 12 are so real. So real. And I see our world trampling over them and making them feel hopeless. Instead of rising them up and letting them know there is hope. Because they need to stick him in the depths of their soul when they're young. I praise God that I knelt at an altar. Well, actually, it started in the Sunday school room when we moved to the altar. We did a lot of praying that day. When I was 9 years old, and I found Jesus Christ as my Savior and Lord. And oh, trust me, it's been an interesting ride. And I don't really like roller coasters that do loop-de-loops. And he's taken me on a few of those loop-de-loop rides a few times in my life. I'm like, whoa! He says, it's over. You're okay? Can't believe I did that. But I'm so grateful. Because now, here I am in my third act of life. And I am so grateful He has spared me and protected me from so many things. And for me to be able to share Jesus Christ with young people, and just see even one of them not to have to suffer so many things that I see adults suffering, is worth it all. Is worth it all. And for them to place Him in our heart when they're young. And if you were able to do that when you were young, but you've made it that now at this point in life that you have placed Him in your heart, savor it. You can't go back, but today is precious. And what is your dream for the future? Where are you going? What are you going to do? How are you going to look? Are you going to be hopeless when things don't work out? Are you going to say, oh, that was one of those roller coaster rides, Lord. Now, what are we doing? I'm holding tight and my knuckles are blue and I am scared witless. I have cried and I have fought and I have thrown fits and I have wept and I have begged through my life many times, Lord, on many, many occasions, on many, many issues. That's where we're all at. So whether you're young or old, where is today? And what are you planning for your future? Where are you planning on going? You know, John 3:16, a simple verse. All of us, if we've ever been connected to church in any shape or form, maybe, I mean, a lot of people go, well, I went to church when I was a kid, and I always went to church, and I remember this. Me and Diana went through this at camp this summer. All of a sudden, I went running through the room one morning, going, good morning, good morning, good morning. Aren't you feeling fine? That's how I torture my personal 6 children every morning to get them up out of bed. And it's from a children's Christian tape. And Diana went, oh, I have not heard that from my mom. I remember when my mom used to sing and play that. And we remember these parts of our childhood. And if you remember this one verse, if you've ever connected in any form in the spiritual realm of a church or a relative that loved God, for God so loved the world, that He gave His only begotten Son. That whosoever believeth in Him should what? Not perish, but what? Have everlasting life. All right! Right there. Because I don't like scary things. I don't have to fear. I am not hopeless. Because if I have faith and I believe in Him that He is the Son of God and He came from heaven for me and our Creator sent Him in my behalf, then when it's my turn to lay down on this earth, I will just go to sleep and I'm going to wake up in the most beautiful place in the entire heavens. And my home is going to be gorgeous and I am going to be gorgeous. No more dieting. And I will have some strength and it will be fab. And even, which is one of my goals, to live to be 100, if you didn't know that, because I want them to announce my birthday on TV when I'm 100 and I'm a pretty little lady. But I won't look pretty in heaven because I will be perfect. He did this for us. He did it for us. He didn't have to. Because we find out, we just did this, a couple, 3 weeks ago. We talked about Noah and that God got to a point, this is already, we're not even in, it's the first book of Genesis, the beginning book of the Bible. And he says, man kind of made me sick of my stomach. I'm sorry I ever made him. But you know what? He didn't just tear it up, write us off. He said, you know, let's correct this, let's figure out. And he's done correction many times over the course of history, many times. Over the course of history, he has done correction. All the way to the New Testament, when he said, you know what? Son, I need you to go down. I need you to represent. I need you to show them. Romans 12:12. Rejoice in hope. There's no less on there. It just says, hope! Be patient in tribulation. Having a rough time, be patient. Oh, I've been patient. And then I've been not patient. it's easier to be patient. It seems like the outcome, you don't have as many headaches, you feel a little bit better. And be consistent in prayer. I think that right there, the communication part, you know, we have a tribulation. So we say, why God? Instead of, okay, God, what do I need to do? Or how can I, where's my place in this? How do I correct this if it's something to do with ourselves? If it's something to do with someone else, Lord, touch them. Let your spirit fall upon them. Surround them. I have three loving children I adore, and I cannot do for them what they need to do for themselves, and that is find Jesus. But, oh, my prayers daily, Lord, surround them with your people. Put them in a place that they feel your love. Put them in a place they hear your scriptures. Put them in a place that they know that they have a reason for being here. Mm-hmm. Father, let your spirit fall down on them when they're alone.
Amen.
God has ways of connecting with us. People that can't sleep, always they start praying. Either God will start talking, or the devil will say, sleep, because God is talking to God.
Yep.
It's one of the two. But be consistent in communication with him. But I will hope continually and will praise you yet more and more, Psalms tells us. The more hope we have, the more joy we're going to have. We talk about that also as kids.
J-O-Y.
I can spell just like Sesame Street. But we want to have joy. We want to have joy. And the more we communicate with him, the more praise we give him, and the more hope we're going to have. Don't be an Eeyore. No Eeyores in the house, right? Woe's me. I do like when people say, like I said at the beginning of service, how is everybody? You know what? There was a sweet little lady. I was under her instruction for about 10 years. I went to a lot of Bible classes, and she always said that was future truth. You know, you may not be perfect today, but you don't want to snuff the hope of someone else and the joy of someone else. So maybe you're not just up to 100% par, but when someone says, how are you? Oh, I'm great, how are you? It's future truth, because if you really understand, maybe you're not perfect or feeling the best or things aren't going the best today, but God's got a plan. It's in motion, and it's going to happen.
Fine.
So just claim it, rejoice in it, and say, I'm good. How about you? Because it's future truth. Future truth. Continually praising him more and more. And what happens when we do that? In Isaiah, it tells us, they who wait upon the Lord shall what? They will renew their strength. Okay, you guys, we're going to get strong. Okay? Yeah, that's right. We're going to get strong. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. Have you ever seen an eagle fly, a big bird soar? It is the most beautiful thing. They shall run and not be weary. I'm not really a good runner. I kind of look kind of gimpy when I run. But God tells me if I stick in there, I'm going to be a really good runner. And don't get weary. Try your best. They shall walk and not faint. Why? Because they have hope. Hope. A four-letter word that so many times is translated into an eight-letter word because we look at the world and we don't look at the mark ahead of us. When we give up on God, we're hopeless. It's sad but true. Maybe you've never had hope. There might be someone here that's never really had hope. They've talked about having hope. Yeah, they believe there's a God. Don't forget, Satan believes there's a God. He used to room with him and got dropkicked. But you never really have searched down that hope. You never really went to the cross and said, I need some hope and I want it all the days of my life. Or maybe you are one of his, and you just kind of got weary, and you stopped running and walking, and you took your eye off the prize. Got a to keep your eye on the prize. When you're in a dark room and there's a flicker of light, my daddy taught me a long time ago, look at the light and walk straight to it. And you'll always make it out. Jesus is our light. Problem is, sometimes we look the other direction and we don't make it out. Keep our eye on the prize and look. And God is so remarkable that he, when he sent Jesus down, he's like, I want to give you reminders of hope. I just shared this the other day with a friend, kind of briefly. There's so many holidays in the world, and I truly believe we should honor our veterans. I truly believe it's a joy to be a mother and honor my mother. Honor our fathers. I have a really wonderful, spectacular daddy. And Jim has been a good daddy. I'm proud to be an American. Boy, am I proud to be an American. This country is not perfect, and we need a lot of prayer. However, there's not another country I would like to lay my feet on and call home. But then I think of holidays that focus around our Savior, Jesus Christ. Think about it, Christmas. How hopeful is Christmas? It's got so much hope. Because when God said, I need to send you down, and I need you to be an example, a guide, show them that they can do it. He did not come in on a white horse. He did not come crashing through the sky with symbols and a rain of angels. But how did he come? Now, this is just my number, so don't say this is what he weighed. He came in as a 7.5, 20-inch long little baby. Cuddly and googly and smelled good most of the time. He came as we come to this world.
Triumphal entry.
As a tiny, tiny baby. And he lived a life as all of us have lived. He learned to take his first step. He learned how to write his name. He grew into a teenager. He learned what peer pressure was. He learned about taking a stand for not just his mother and father and family, but his father. He grew into an adult, was wrongfully accused. He has experienced any and everything we would ever experience as a human being. He gave us hope. And then for 3 years, he walked this earth and he shared the good news of his father and his home and said, I'm not here to judge anybody or tell you who you are or what you are. You already know that. But I'm here to share with you love. And from love, you will find hope. And from hope, you will find in me a belief system that there is no other. And we will bond and we will grow. And I will be there for you morning, noon, and night. You can do this. Don't we waste all our kids that? You can do this. You can do this. You can do this. You can do this. I even tell my grown kids now, you can do this. Our oldest daughter, Corey, everybody pretty much knows she's getting ready to birth her second child here in, at the end of November. She's getting tired. First pregnancy, she didn't have no one running around the house. Addie is running around the house. That two-year-old is going after it. Up the stairs, down the stairs, in the garage, the backyard. You know, she's everywhere, you know. Lost her the other day. She was in the cupboard in the island. And he's like, get out of there. What are you doing? You know, she's funny, you know, sticking Cheetos up her nose. You name it, she's doing it. She's doing it. Now, Corey's expecting the second one. Her body's getting tired. I told her, honey, you can do this. We've all done it. All of us mommies have been there. You thought the first one was hard? Get ready for a ride of your life. But it's a beautiful ride. It's a beautiful ride. And God tells us even with more encouragement, you can do this. Christmas is a time of, I love Christmas. I love Christmas trees. I love seeing those trees because they're evergreen, which means life forever. I love looking at a candy cane and knowing it represents the shepherds that stayed out in the fields cold one night and the angels burst through. It said, fear not, for I bring you good tidings. I love to share gifts and goodies with people because I want to be like one of those kings that brought goodness and love. And by me doing it to others, I'm doing it unto him, according to scripture. But as he grew, we know what happens at age 33, he was wrongfully accused. But Easter brings us hope. Why does Easter bring us hope? Because when he was at that day of his judgment, and they proceeded to prepare him for crucifixion, he took a beating like no other. And he did it for me.
Yeah.
He hung on that cross and spilled the words of love out, saying, forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do. Wow. Hope. Even then, he had hope for us. And when he closed his eyes, yes, remember this, he closed his eyes. He gave up the spirit. They did not do it. He did it. And they took his body down, they wrapped it, and they placed it into the tomb there for 3 days. Hope. Because that was the wrestling ring of all wrestling rings. Hope. He wrestled the devil. He fought and said, listen, dude, I've had enough of this. You have mistreated our family enough. You have told them they are hopeless. And I am taking the keys of life from you. And anyone and everyone that believes in me and believes that I am the Son of God and that I have came down from heaven to show them as an example for 33 years that they can do it will have hope. And you can do whatever you want to them on this earth, to their fleshly beings, but you will never touch their spirits. And you may break their will, but their spirit will be mighty.
Amen.
And on that third day, that stone rolled away, and we know what happened. When the women came, he's not here. What do you mean he's not here? He's not here. He's risen. Because he took those keys of life. He says, there's hope, people. I'm holding the keys of life now. You're taken care of. If we believe, if we will trust, if we will have confidence and courage. It's not easy, but we can do it. He tells us we can do it and we can have hope. We don't have to be hopeless. We can be victorious, victorious. And sometimes when we're victorious, it's hard to get the victory. Don't you agree? It's hard. Well, those guys play on the football field. They just don't run from one end to the other, and no one touched them, or nothing happened. They're like, woo, score, woo, score. We won. No. It's hard work. That's the reason I don't play football. But we can do it. Because anything worth having is worth fighting for. Wouldn't you agree? That's the reason I get a little bit personal when people kind of make fun of the church. I use God's name in vain. Or kind of talk ill of Christians. Because it's personal to me. Jesus is mine. I'll share him with you, but he's mine. But the part you get, you'll share him. But there's still that part that's yours. And you can take it personal. You can take it personal. Today is a time for us to think. Do we have more hopelessness in our life, or do we have more hope? If we have too much hopelessness, maybe we need to rethink things and reevaluate things and think, God, where am I not holding on tight enough? What have I not given you? What have I not totally laid out for you? He knows what's in our closet, but we just kind of hiding it there, and we just kind of like, well, you know this, this, and this about me, but there's also this. As kids, we kind of do that, right? We tell mom, dad, like, that got broken. It kind of like, I don't know, fell off the table. No, it wasn't me. It might have been you named your sibling, or you named the dog. In reality, you and your sibling and the dog were wrestling and playing, and it didn't fall. It got knocked off the table, and it went, and it broke. And there you are, trying to explain your way out. And she's just saying, we were playing in the house, and I went sliding around the table to catch the football, and I hit it, and she hit me, and it all tumbled to the floor. That's kind of how we are with God. We just tell him the surface things. And even though he knows the deep things, he wants to hear it from our mouths because it will set us free. And when we're free, we have hope. And when we have hope, we're not hopeless. See how this all works? God wants us to have hope. Diana is going to play a song for us in this. She plays this song. I want all you girls in the front row, you're going to think of things that you trust God with, and you're also going to think of things and you're write down where you need help from God. No one's going to see this but you and God, okay? You're going to be quiet, and you're going to do that. All the rest of us, we're going to just take this time of prayer. You can come up front to pray. You can pray right where you're at. Where do you fall in the world? Are you hopeless, or do you have hope? Are you kind of on the fence? It's not a good place to be. It's kind of very uncomfortable, actually. Where are you? Where do you need to rearrange your life so that you have hope all the time, even in the sad times? The day my daddy died, and I called Jim and told him it's not going well. And I was with probably 40 relatives. And a cousin says, it's hopeless. I said, oh, no. I refuse. And he goes, well, they're already telling you. I said, they already told me. And I do not expect him to stay on this earth. But it's not hopeless. God has spared him. God granted him his dreams. He did not want to be someone that had to be tended to medically for long spans of time. And God just dropped him to the ground with a major heart attack. He never, ever came back. No brain activity. He worked on him for 3 days. I said, there's hope. God granted him. God just said, Jerry, it's time. It's time. And he's worked hard. He shared the gospel all his days as long as I can remember. And he showed us and told us how to find hope. And he was kind of like the leader of the pack in the family. Because his daddy died when he was 15, and so he still had 6 siblings below him. So he became a daddy at 16 of 6 children. With a mother in a dairy, and he worked full-time at the dairy, went to school full-time in high school, and he played football, and he wrestled, and he reared his siblings. He worked hard, but he never gave up. There was always hope. Never heard my daddy yell in my life, but I knew if he gave me a certain look, you almost wish he did yell, because that look was penetrating. It hurt. And I was always taught, you come up against a demon or a snake, you don't play with it, you cut its head off. My dad told me, you work hard. Because the Bible says if a man don't work, a man don't eat. I like to eat. Sitting there that day with my cousin reminding him of all these things, because you're right. He said, there's hope. We have to remember the example, the legacy he left behind for us. And God has granted him his wish.
Yeah.
And now he is just resting. And he's getting ready to wake up in a place that he has dreamed about and prepared for all his days. There's hope. Sure, I shed a tear. Makes me want two tears trickling down my cheek right now. But they're not tears of sadness. They're tears of joy. I've had many moments in my life where I was sad to give up something, like my babies, my daddy, my grandma, moving from a town that I'm comfortable in, away from my parents, dealing with people that I don't think really even care if I breathe. But there's hope. There's hope. Because I've always had Jesus. We want to stay focused on the prize. What's your prize? Where are you focused? If you're not focused on the prize, right now is the time to take care of it. And if you are, rejoice and ask for strength to go further and longer. Diana, go ahead and start that music. Let's just take this time. that you are our only hope.
Yes.
Dear Father, we ask that you would break the barriers down around us that sometimes we hold on to. And dear Father, if there's one person in this room that has never, ever sought you for true hope, they will do it today.
Yes.
Dear Father, that you watch over all of us, from the youngest to the oldest. That you guide us and help us to put on those wings as, that we can soar like eagles. Dear Father, that we will give you joy and praise more and more because we know you are our hope.
Yes.
And dear Father, that you would guide us out of this building, that we would be a ray of hope and sunshine to this world we live in. Our families, our neighbors, our co-workers, people we see in the stores. Dear Father, help us disappear and let them see you. Dear Father, I just praise you and thank you for all you do, all you've done, and all that you're so willing still to do for us. Father, I just cannot give you enough praise. Jesus, I love you and I thank you.
Yeah, Lord.
We ask all this in the precious name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, the Son of God, the King of Kings, and the Lord of Lords. Amen.